Hi, everybody. I'm here with Trevor Stewart, and we are going to walk through how we record Etude of the Week. All right, Trevor, take it away. What do you do first?
All right. So the very first thing I do is I make sure that my microphone and my camera are set up. So for making the videos, I usually use my iPhone camera. And what I'll do is sometimes I'll just like sit it on my music stand, but it's, as you probably have found out, it's not the most flattering angle. And so I think both of us have some sort of device or a clip to where you can hold your or secure your iPhone. So I use this long clip that attaches to like a tabletop or a bookshelf or really anything. It screws down and it's very stable. And on the other end is a clamp that holds your iPhone. And I kind of first start by finding my an ideal angle. This thing is really flexible. It's just like a metal rod inside. So once you find your video angle set up, that's the easy part. You want to make sure that,
where did you get this thing
I bought on Amazon for about $25. Okay. And the brand is called Lamical, L-A-M-I-C. I think it's an O-L-L.
Okay. And I'll look that stuff up and I can always, we can always put links later. And sure. This is what I use. I have a little flexible tripod. That's what I set my phone up with. You can bend the legs any way that you want. I even put this on the top of my music stand and kind of bend the legs when I want to do a more downward angle, like towards my fingers. But I got this on eBay for like, I want to say like $5 or $6, and I'll find a link for that too and share that.
Right. That's kind of, I think the whole theme of today is how to do this on a budget.
Yeah.
Without spending hundreds of dollars on really fancy equipment. Obviously we both have some step up microphones. Yeah. That's an investment, but even if you don't necessarily have those microphones, you can still follow all of the same steps.
Yeah. And I guess so, we can talk about that too. Like, this is super basic. You don't have to have any kind of recording knowledge. Trevor's like 3 or 4 steps ahead of me, and I'm like one step ahead of anyone who's never done this. So I will ask him questions as he walks us through. I'll be the dummy asking the questions because I still have questions when I get to some things. So I'll make sure I ask the questions I asked him the first time so that we're kind of covering all the bases.
Right. And this isn't, just full disclaimer, I'm not by any means, I'm not an expert on audio recording, video editing, audio editing. I'm literally in the same position that everyone else is. I just got really fed up with having very base level sound quality, like from my built-in speakers, built-in microphones. So,
I mean, we work hard. Like, everybody in this group works hard to record and practice each week. And I would love for everybody to benefit from being able to really share their real sound. So if that's something that you're wanting to do, then stick with us.
Yeah. And if you have Apple devices, that will be the platform that we're working from today. For me, I do all of my recording of video on my iPhone and audio on my iPad. So I'm doing all of this and demonstrating all of this stuff from an iPad today. The same apps and the same functions apply on the iPhone. It might look a little bit different. And then I know, like in your case, you're using like a Mac computer, and it won't look the same, but I know the same features are there. We might just have to translate a bit. So
my version is really old. So if we happen to screen share on mine, just keep in mind, it's a 5-year-old program that I'm running.
So the next thing I do after I get my video set up is I will set up my microphone. And I found that if I'm 3 to 5 feet away from the microphone, that's a good distance. I think if I got too close to, and I know a lot of people record a lot closer, but for me, for my microphone, and I use the Shur MV88 Plus, and also when I was trying the Blue Yeti, I didn't sound very good when I was within like 1 or 2 of the microphone. I like to get a little bit of distance.
I have a Blue Yeti. And I do probably about 3 to 5 feet away, depending on what I'm doing. So.
Right. So sometimes with the clarinet, you know, it can be a noisy instrument, not the sound, but the keys.
Yeah.
sometimes if you get like little leaks of air out of your embouchure, things like that, you know, everything will be picked up if you have it too close. Yeah. So get a little bit of distance and you can experiment, record, listen back and see like where is it, you know, where's a good placement.
That's exactly what I did. I picked all the features because there's four different features. So I just tried each one and I tried each one at different distances and I just sort of kept track of what created the best sound, because you can ask people what to put it on, or you can just figure it out for yourself, you know, the sound that you like.
And Michael Lawnstern has some really awesome videos on mic placement and microphones in general. But he uses a bass clarinet, I think, in those examples. So
okay.
I think for me, I generally like it to be slightly above the instrument. Definitely not toward the bell. Somewhere in the middle, like somewhere up,
yeah.
In the middle and up is usually best. So once I get my microphone in the right place and I have my camera in the right place, then I'll go into GarageBand and I'll start screen sharing now. Okay. So that you can see that. So I go into GarageBand and this is the first thing you're going to see. If you don't see this yet, you have to just create a new file. So this is the home screen. And you just tap the plus sign in the upper corner. You have some options here. Just make sure that you go to audio recorder and then just tap in the middle of that giant button. And this is what pops up. So on the iPad and the iPhone, I know it's not like this on the computer, but you have an 8-bar track that's preset to record only that amount of time. And so it defaults to this and it's quite annoying. I've started recording and then realized that it stops after 8 bars. So what you have to do is to click the small plus sign here in the upper corner and then click on section A. And then for the length, instead of manual, which is what it's set to now, at 8 bars, just click automatic. And that will make sure that the audio recording continues indefinitely until you stop playing. And even beyond that, it really won't stop until you tell it to. So,
and that is something really you have important. To do each time you open the application, right?
Every time, that's step one. I always do that just because I've not done it a few times and that was extremely frustrating, so.
Okay. So if anybody happens to know of a way to make that happen all the time, please let us know.
Yeah, thank you. And the next step for me, and this depends on the microphone you're using. Some USB microphones that people use record in 16-bit and others record in 24-bit. The Shure records 24-bit audio. I think the Blue Yeti does 16-bit, but it just depends. And if you don't know, you can literally just type in the name of your microphone followed by bit rate into Google and it'll tell you immediately. But if you are running...
Why is that information important? Because I don't even know what any of that is.
So 24 bit rate is, I I'm like, this is where me heavily generalizing comes in. I'm not an expert on this, but from what I understand, the 24 bit is going to pick up a wider range of frequencies. So for our purposes, I mean, uploading to Facebook, I think the quality is already like compromised anyway, just because of the Facebook like compression.
Okay.
So I don't think it's like super important for Etude of the Week. But if you do have a 24-bit microphone, the reason I say that is there's an option in the settings. If you tap the cog in the top corner, followed by advanced, 24-bit audio resolution is an option. So just to maximize your recording quality, if you do have a 24-bit microphone, just go ahead and turn that option on.
And if you don't, is it going to mess with anything?
If you have it turned off, it'll default, I believe, to 16-bit audio.
Okay.
Which is probably the majority of microphones. So that's only if you know for sure that you have that functionality on your microphone. But it's really not important. It's just something that I like to mention because it can help, you know, use your microphone to its fullest potential.
Okay.
And that setting will stay the same. Pretty much all the settings will remain the same-ish moving forward. There's not much you have to do like every single time, like we did with the automatic sectioning. So
okay, yeah. Okay.
So next thing we do, and I'm sure this is what you do as well, is you need to adjust your audio input level to make sure that you're recording at a decent volume that isn't peaking, that isn't distorting the microphone, but is also loud enough for you to hear.
So we're talking about this little green line that's on the left side of the page. It's barely sprouting. But if you play your clarinet and play a couple of notes and see how high that line goes, you want to make sure you're not overwhelming your input, so you can turn that down.
Right, exactly. So, sorry. You see, if I tap on my microphone, sorry, this is going to be loud. It goes up significantly, but I don't have my microphone set to a super high volume right now. And so it didn't really distort too much. But if, yeah, so when you're testing it, what I would do is just click on record at the top. And I actually have this built-in microphone turned on right now, but I usually turn it off. So if you are recording a multi-track recording, for instance, where you're playing a duet or a trio with yourself, it's kind of nice to have the metronome. I think I said microphone earlier. Turned on. Sorry about that, my English. Anyway, it's going to continually click forever if you don't turn it off. So I turn it off because I think it's quite annoying when you're trying to record just a solo or an etude. So make a little recording and then listen back. Not only are you listening, you're watching to see if at any point the monitor is going into the red zone.
Are you talking about that little blue line in the middle?
This is just like the background color of the audio track. Obviously, it's not recording me right now because my voice, I think, is going into Zoom. I'm talking about over here. You can see the little green line.
Oh, the kind green. Of, okay.
Right, right.
I know I've recorded and it shows levels within the recording and they like peak at red, you know.
Oh, sure. I don't think that's a function in the iPad version, but I know what you're talking about.
Okay.
So basically, when I am testing the audio level, I just have my headphones on and making sure that at about 75% of the volume turned up on your device, that you have a full, rich sound that's like a good volume, but isn't too much. You should be able to turn your headphones to the max and still, you know, have it not be distorted. But I like to usually turn my headphones to about 75% just to make sure that at that normal listening level, the quality is still good.
Where is it that you do 75%? Where is
that? Oh, that's just like on the, as far as like my headphone volume goes. So like the buttons on the side of my phone or the buttons on the side of my iPad.
Okay.
Right. So you can also adjust the listening level here, the output, which you can see when I move the slider up and down here, it's also adjusting this. So these are the same.
So does that stay wherever you put that output, does that stay for when you finalize the sound?
Yes, it will.
Okay, that's nice.
So if you record and it's extremely wild and loud, you can just bump it down a little bit. But if it recorded some distortion, like if you really, really overpowered your microphone, you can, and it gets kind of crunchy sounding, you get the hissing or the sizzling noise on some higher frequencies. Even if you turn this down, it's still going to have the same hissing or kind of popping. It's just going to be a softer version of it.
Yeah,
so you really need to make sure that the initial input is set to a good level. It's easier to add a little bit than to take it away.
Right. Okay.
The other thing that I wanted to mention when you're testing your audio levels, when you if you have your headphones on and you tap this button here, it just turned orange.
Wait, where are you at? Because I don't see anything moving. So that's the thing that's tricky.
So this is in the top left part of the screen where it says audio recorder.
Okay.
There, right next to this bar here is a button that turns orange when I tapped it.
Okay.
That is the monitoring button. So when that's turned on, you're hearing kind of like a doubled up recognition of your microphone. So like you're hearing your own voice like come through the microphone at the same time as the audio track is playing. So like if I were to press play to test my audio, and then I have that button turned on to orange, I'm not only gonna hear the audio that's coming from this recording I just made, I'm going to hear all the noise that's still coming through my microphone. So you need to make sure that that's turned off when you're just listening back. White is off. If that's turned on, you're going to think that your recording sounds much more muddy and gross than it actually does, because you're going to be hearing the noise of the room being picked up through your microphone. So you kind of have your microphone noise and the iPad recording playing at the same time. So that's just kind of annoying. I had made the mistake of having this turned on and then thinking that my recording sounded really bad. And then I realized it was turned on and I was like, oh, that's not the recording. That's just the air conditioner playing through my microphone.
So, but when you're recording, do you have to turn that to orange?
I don't wear the headphones when I'm recording. So if I'm recording, right. So if I'm playing, yeah, it's called monitoring. It's just like, think of like a monitor, just like you would have like on a stage, for instance.
Okay.
If I'm recording just a solo piece or an etude of the week, I have it turned off. This is useful though, is if when you're doing multi-track recording, if you want to play a duet or quartet or whatever with yourself, that is going to allow you to hear the recording that you made in addition to the recording or the sound that you're playing on top of that. So I do use the monitoring when I'm doing multi-track recording. Okay. But for these purposes, I would just turn it off.
So that's another thing we can talk about briefly. Like if you're going to record a duet with yourself, you would have to create another track. And then
right.
first you would record whatever part you want to record first. And then you would select the metronome to be on. And the metronome through GarageBand is not going to be in the recording. That's just for your own purposes. So you have your headphones on so you can hear that click.
Mm-hmm.
And then when you create a new track below that, you will record it, but you have your headphones on and you can hear the other part while you're recording the second part.
Exactly. And I want to come back to creating that second track in just a moment.
Okay.
What I want to share really quick is once you have yourself set up, you've recorded your audio, you've recorded your video at the same time, and you get to this point where let's just pretend that this blue rectangle here is our audio recording. And now we want to make it sound a little bit better, because sometimes the audio that goes, you know, that comes from your GarageBand recording, the raw, unedited audio doesn't always sound great because you hear, like for instance, I said earlier, you can hear your air conditioner noise if it's loud, or you have some street noise, or you have some air leaking, or maybe some key clicking and or loud breathing, all of those sorts of little noises that can creep into the recording. I have a strategy to sort of help remove some of that sound. And then also I was going to show everyone a plugin, which is basically just like a downloadable app that is a more natural sounding reverb than the one built into GarageBand.
Oh, okay.
So those two things are really easy fixes and they can really help the audio quality immensely. So I don't know what this looks like on the computer version, but I'll go ahead and show you now what that looks like here. So you first start by going into the top left corner. You kind of, I'm at the fourth button over right here.
Okay.
And that opens up some settings. And this is a button called, that says plugins and EQ. You tap that. And what you have here is just some audio editing options. These are very basic versions of things that these are sort of the more powerful features of GarageBand that you would find kind of standard, or if you're really knowledgeable of audio editing, like these are going to make perfect sense to you. But if you have no idea what's going on, these are basically just little add-ons or little tools that you can add on to your recording that will alter the sound in some way. And each tool has a specific function. So I'm going to show you two of them that I use regularly that I think helps get a higher quality sound. So one of them's already built in and one you have to download. So I'll show you that now. So what you do, and again, I'm sorry, I don't know what this looks like on the computer.
That's okay.
But
don't worry.
You tap edit, and then you see these slots where I have green plus signs and it says none. So these are places where I can add plugins. So the first one is automatically built in, and you just go over to the top tab, audio unit and extensions. Any of these that have AU in front are made by Apple. So these are built in already. So you should already have these in onto your on your device. the one that I like to recommend is the low pass filter. So AU low pass filter. And what that means, it's not too scary, don't worry. All that means is that anything below a certain frequency level that you set, and I'll show you how to do that, it gets a pass. So it gets to come through in the sound. But anything above that set frequency level will be faded down or washed away. So those higher frequencies are things like air noise, street noise, key noise. Like,
takes the stuff off the top.
Exactly. Okay. And that's one of the nice things. A lot of people recommend using a ribbon microphone for clarinet recording. You might have seen that tossed around. Uh-huh. I think ribbon microphones inherently take some of that edge off the top. And that's one of the reasons that's really suitable for the clarinet. We do have a lot of higher frequencies that can come through. I mean, just inherently in the instrument, it can be quite bright.
Yeah, I've made a few recordings where even at a low volume, there's some notes that just get under my skin. I'm like, why is that so loud?
Right. And so what we do is once you've added it, I can tap on this and it opens up some options. There's two options here. So the first one is cutoff frequency. So this is the point into which you will for instance, I usually set mine to around 12,000 ish, anywhere in the 12,000 range, because I think the clarinet pretty much creates frequencies that go up to between 10 and 12,000 hertz. So anything above that, we don't even need. That's just muddying the sound on our recording. And so I usually set it somewhere between 12 and 13,000. And again, you can click play on your recording and listen back. This is going to edit the sound after you've recorded. So you can experiment. Where does it sound the best? Oh, what setting sounds the best? It's kind of like when you go and you edit a photo in your camera app, for instance, which filter looks the best, that kind of thing. Okay. So what I do then is I'll actually turn the resonance down. So that's actually just gonna turn the decibel level of those frequencies down anywhere above 12,000, for instance. So you can adjust to where you think it sounds the most natural or where you think it sounds the best, but always bringing it down below zero will be how to get rid of those sounds. Okay. So once you find the setting you think sounds best, then that's set and it's toggled on. Oops, sorry. It's toggled on, as you can see with this, I keep hitting the wrong button, this little blue power emblem there.
Oh, okay, I see.
So the other one that I found to be really helpful is, it's actually a third party app for reverb. And I like this better than the GarageBand reverb. I just think it has a more natural sound and it has a little bit more fine adjustments that you can make. Okay. So what you have to do is click find more on the app store. And when you click that, what will happen is it will open this list of all of these different apps that you can plug in to GarageBand to edit your sound and to get different effects. And you could really have fun just playing with some of these things. But the one that I found that works really well is called Zero Reverb, as you can see it here.
Okay.
With the red bomb. And I've already had mine. It was free, by the way. I didn't pay for it, but I downloaded it. So mine just says open. So since it's already there, that opens the app, but you don't even need to do that because it does download as an app onto your device. But once it's on your device, you can edit it and add it directly from GarageBand. So I'll go to this second free slot and I'll go over to audio unit extensions, and you can see it's at the very top, zero reverb. And then I just add that. And then if you look at the settings, there are some scary looking options, and it's really not that bad once you understand what all of these things mean. So before I go into this, I just want to make sure that you don't have any questions before I talk about like what each of these things means.
I think I'm good.
Okay.
Do you happen to have like an audio sample you could drag in so we could hear all the differences, or is that something?
I could do that for sure. I'm going to open one of the previous Etudes of the Week that I recorded. So I'm going to just click play and tell me if you hear the audio coming through. Okay, great. So I'm going to go to zero reverb, and I will talk about these options. Basically, there are only a few of them that are going to make a big difference for the clarinet sound. So the most important ones are mid time, low time. This is basically the amount of time that the reverb or the decay is going to last. And the mid just refers to mid to like higher frequencies. So the clarinet will contain mostly the frequencies that are in this option. So you'll notice that when you adjust this, if I were to drag it out to like 30 seconds, like it's gonna be really bad. So, right. So, I mean, it sounds awesome, but we wanna turn that down. And I think for a more natural sound, anywhere between like 1 to 1.4 or 1.5 will sound good. You don't wanna go too far because it just starts to sound really fake, you know?
If
you're recording in a carpeted room and you sound like you're in a cathedral, it's not always the best. So the low time will be like the amount of time that your lower frequencies are echoing, but these don't really apply to B flat clarinet. Like it's not going to make a difference if I like turn this here. It still sounds nice even without this adjustment. So don't even worry about that. I usually just keep it matched with mid time. And the next option is sort of related to that, mid versus low frequencies. It's called crossover. And crossover is again for lower frequencies, basically. Sometimes the bass reverb can really start to overpower the sound. So the lower frequencies, like if I had like a bass or a cello or something, and that reverb might really overpower the sound of the clarinet, or it might last too long. So the crossover, it basically lets you choose like at which point, at which level of hertz low and the high, the mid time and the low time split. So for instance, if I wanted to, it doesn't really matter, you don't really need to know this, but if I wanted to make my mid time, if I wanted to make the mid time more clear, if I had bass that was overpowering, I would basically just turn this crossover down so that it's fading out sooner, the bass frequencies, but we don't need to worry about that. Damping, the next one, this is like the absorption of high frequencies in the reverb. So like if you lower, basically all you need to know is if you lower the damping, you're going to get a brighter sound. So, and it might last longer. I'm sorry, I meant the other way around. If you turn it up, you're going to get a brighter sound.
Okay.
And I think that sounds really bright, so I just turn it to where I think it sounds the best. That's a lot of this is just trial and error.
Sure.
For the delay, I always have it set at zero. I like the sound, the reverb sound, to just start immediately upon the execution of the note. Otherwise, if you have it turned up, it's like it's like a delay pedal. So I just always have that turned down. And then mix is the percentage of dry sound versus reverb sound. So like if I have it turned all the way down, you'll hear nothing. And if you turn it all the way up, it's all reverb and it does not sound nice either. I usually like it somewhere around 50 to 60%, normally on the lower side of 50%. So once you play with all of these settings, you can find a sound that really is warm and resonant and natural sounding, not just like a prepackaged reverb that you don't have very many options to adjust, if that makes sense.
Sure, sure.
And again, really excuse my explanation of what these things mean. I barely even understand myself. But what I can say is that your ear will tell you whether or not it sounds good or bad. So just play with it a little bit and you'll find something that you like. So that is pretty much the only sort of like editing I will do. One other thing you can do is you can adjust. This is just back on your main screen. I basically backed out of the plugins once I had those set. And then you can go here. And if you want to like fine tune, you can play with the treble and the bass levels just to see where you think it sounds the nicest. You might have done that a little bit with your recordings. I don't know if you've done any of this stuff or not. I know I've heard reverb and it sounds like you've adjusted something. So it sounds nice.
What I do is the reverb, and then when I put it into iMovie, I set the volume to 50% in iMovie.
Right.
That's about the extent of what I do. I have the reverb.
So you find that
17%, I think it's in the old version of GarageBand where you select the percent of reverb and it's like 17%.
So you found that when you move it into iMovie, the sound needs to be turned down, the audio level.
Yeah, it's just a little bright.
I found the same thing. I actually set mine to 50% as well.
Okay.
So that's a kind of a good place for me to pick up where we were talking about multi-track recording. So if you've recorded your first part, your top line, and you want to add the second line, if you just click the plus sign here at the bottom and add another thing, add another track, that's going to add an entire new track that has no audio adjustments whatsoever. What I like to do is to basically duplicate this. So I just tap and hold for a minute and it gives me some options. And I'm assuming this is the same as right clicking on your computer, and you can click duplicate. And what that did was it took all of my reverb and my low pass filter settings and my compression settings and it copied it onto this track. And so now when I make a recording, in the second part, the sound quality will match the first part.
Oh, that's nice.
So that's why I wanted to delay just a little bit before I mentioned how to do that.
Yeah,
so
yeah, smart.
once we'll go ahead and delete this, but once you've got your recording, sorry, someone keeps messaging me.
That's okay.
You basically then can go up to the top corner and click the little page here, and it takes you back
left or right.
Yeah, top left.
Top left. Okay.
Mm-hmm. And then you have your recording, and then you can hold down that or right click, and click on share at the bottom. And you want to share it as a song. You can also make it a ringtone if you really want. So listen to yourself play Etudes as your ringtone.
Oh,
and since I move it directly into iMovie, another Apple program, I just use Apple Lossless. You could also use Wave as another kind of high quality resolution. Either will work fine. So then from there, you just click share, and you can edit the title and all of that stuff. But I just usually leave it. I click share. And then what I'll do is click open in, and once it exports, you can go over here to open an iMovie, and it takes, create a new movie, and that takes your audio recording and it puts it right in to iMovie. So from here, you might wanna, if you want, you can talk about how what you do for your process of adding the video to this audio. We might have similar or different techniques. So sure. Do you have anything to say about that?
Well, so when you're done recording your video and your audio, you're going to push stop on both devices, obviously. And then you're going to have a video recording on your phone, which will also have audio. And we'll talk about how to turn that audio off, because you're not going to want the audio mm-hmm. from your tinny microphone of your phone.
Right.
But you got to drag that into iMovie. And so you got to get it to your computer somehow, or whatever device you're using. And that's when I do the what did you guys call it?
The airdrop?
Airdrop. Thank you.
Right.
So you and select the video and you airdrop it to your laptop or your iPad, whatever you're going to use iMovie on.
Right. And you can get it. However, what I think airdrop is the fastest way to get something from Apple to Apple device. You could obviously like email it to yourself, but that kind of takes a long time.
Sometimes the files are too big. Like mine won't let me do that.
Right.
Would it work in Google Drive also?
It should, yeah. Okay. It should work fine. So whatever way, if you have questions about your specific way of getting it from device to device, you can send us a message and we should be able to answer that question. But let's say that we now have this audio recording and then we want to just add the video. So you can go up to this video section here and let's see. If I have, like, this is just another, these are just some of the recordings that I made. So I think these already have audio on them, but we'll just say that these are the raw video that we took during our recording. And I just add that in, but using the plus sign. And so now on the top, you have your video, and on the bottom in the green, you have your audio. So what you do is to remove that sound from the video, you just tap on it, and at the bottom here you see a volume button, and then you just drag it all the way down and it mutes it. Not sure exactly how that works on the computer. If they might be similar.
My program is so old and different, but it has all the same features, it just looks different.
Right. And then from there, you'll have an audio and a video recording that are not lined up.
Right.
I should have mentioned this earlier. We forgot to talk about the clap. Okay. So at the beginning, right. So at the beginning, before you make your audio and video recording, you want to make sure that you clap like 3 times so that you can see and hear that clap. And that will help you line up your video and audio.
Yeah. Because you'll see 3 little spikes on your audio.
Right.
And you'll
see like
3 spikes on your video too, before you turn the sound off. And then you can line up those spikes visually. And then on mine, I can zoom in like really close and really line that up perfectly.
Right. So like what I usually do is I'll just like take, I don't always see those. I don't have those lines actually.
Oh, maybe I'll have to show you mine later.
Right. Let me exit out of this setting. But I basically just, if let's say my video is too, it's my claps on my video are coming early. I just grab this, oops, not like that. I just make sure I highlight the video and I just grab the edge and I just drag it over until it lines up. So this is shrinking the video. It's cutting off time from the beginning of the video, but it's not editing the audio at all. So like on the iPad, this is what I do. I just grab whichever one is early. And then I just shorten it a little bit. And so that will, you can just line it up and you just press play and you just make sure, it usually takes me like 3 tries to make sure everything's lined up. But again, it's all about the kind of trial and error. I think in lining it up, you don't always get it the first time, but it's really easy to like adjust. And you can always see, oh, my fingers are a little bit ahead. Let me scoot this video back just a little bit. The clap though with the peaks, that sounds a lot easier. I usually just eyeball it with my finger, where my fingers and my or my hands and my sound are lined up together. So
I did that once because I forgot to clap once and it worked out
right.
Fine.
So yeah. If you don't clap, it's not a big deal. You can still totally line it up.
Yeah.
I wanted to say another thing. If your video, for instance, let me add this one and delete this one. If your video is in portrait mode, And as you see, iMovie functions by default in landscape mode. Mm-hmm. So if you happen to record or you want to record your video in the portrait orientation or up and down, what you can do is if you just leave it normal, like if you don't do anything, it's going to export the video with black around the edges on the sides. It'll be a skinny version of your video inside of like a giant black rectangle. So if you want to fix that, what you can do is take two fingers and you can physically like rotate your video. Now this is a square, so it doesn't make a difference, but as you could see, if this was a long portrait mode video, it would fill up this entire space. So like, let me grab this one.
Sideways, does it fix it later?
Right, okay, so I was actually gonna say these are really unflattering videos of myself, but there you can see it. And so what you can do is then, once you're done and you have your things synced up, again, you wanna make sure that your audio on your recording is turned, the volume's turned down like 50%, like we said earlier.
Oh, right, yeah.
And then you'd basically just tap done, and then you have a movie. And let me go ahead and show you then how to export that. So you finalized it, you're done. On the iPad, you just click the share button, and then I usually just click save video, and that'll save it to your, I usually save in 1080p, and you it takes it right to your photo library. So from there in your photos, it'll show up first thing. And what you can do is go to edit. Again, really flattering image of myself. And then you can just rotate it. And that's how you can get it to go from iMovie to portrait orientation without compromising the size of the video. You can avoid all of that together if you just record in landscape orientation to begin with. But I think it's nice sometimes to use the portrait mode because you can get a better view of your fingers that way.
Oh yeah, definitely.
And then from there, I mean, it's in your photo library. You can upload it directly to Facebook and into the group, and it should work. I mean, I usually do one final listen while it's in my photo library just to make sure it sounds okay and all the levels are adjusted before I upload it. But otherwise, that is the process in a nutshell, and that sounds like a lot.
Once you figure it out, it goes really quick. Like I sit down, of course I practice, make sure I'm warmed up, and then I'm like, okay, I'm ready to record, set up the phone, set up the file in GarageBand, basically get all my settings in place, which takes about 3 minutes for that whole process, and I'm ready to record. So it's just a few extra little steps to really benefit from a better sounding submission to Etude of the Week. It's really nice.
Right. And we went into some extreme detail, and you don't have to do all of those things, but once you get the hang of it, it really does go very quickly. Like you'll add the filter, the low pass filter, you'll add your reverb, you'll find a general setting that works for you, and you just kind of like move it to that setting each time.
Yeah.
I think the most time consuming part is combining it in iMovie, and even then it's not that big of a deal.
Sure.
Hopefully that's helpful and not overwhelming, because this was not meant to be overwhelming, but I like to provide as much detail as I can. So
sure. And if anyone is watching this and you happen to be running like a really old version of GarageBand, and actually I could share the screen real quick just so that you can see what that looks like. Okay, are you seeing this?
Yes.
Okay, so this is what it looks like when I open up my super old version of GarageBand. So I'll just say new project and acoustic instrument, and then I choose that. And then I give it a title. 19 is next, right? So this is what it looks like when I first open. When you first open, these two things are checked, metronome and snap to grid, and I don't want those. So I'm going to go in and uncheck those because I don't want the click track. And snap to grid has to do with editing. It snaps to the grid where you can't like really get in there and fine tune your editing. So I don't like that feature in there. Then I go over here to the right, and I click band instrument. And then I clicked tenor sax because it was the closest thing to a clarinet. And then I come down here and then I can pick the clarinet. I don't understand this at all. This is just what I have discovered. And then I go
in case
here to
you don't
edit.
Know which instrument you're playing.
Yeah. And then here's my master reverb that's automatically set at 17% when I choose those features.
And this looks like the place where you could add in those EQ settings, the plugins that we were talking about.
Yeah. See, I don't pay attention to that because I didn't know what all that stuff was. So now I have
so it looks like you have four. Yeah, you have four free slots to play with.
That's cool. And then I just push record. So it's going to record here. Then I push stop. And then when that's done, I save it. And then I'm trying to think what I do after that. Oh, yeah. And then I get out of it and it's going to ask me, do you see that window?
I do.
Okay, so I do want to save it in iLife Preview because that is going to automatically send it to iMovie so I can pull the file from there and I don't have to do anything else. So it'll already be saved in that. I guess iLife Preview just sort of makes it talk to all of your i applications. So then I open iMovie, which I will open it and then I'll screen share again. All right, this is what my iMovie looks like. Then I say create new, and then I choose movie because I'm customizing what I'm making. Now, do you see this screen that popped up?
Yep.
Okay, good. So then I go to audio. And that Nocentini 19 that I just kind of fake recorded is there. And I just drag it down here and let go. I don't know why, but sometimes I have to do it twice. There we go. So that's just the audio of us talking, which we could hear that. So it's going to record here. And I push. Okay, so that's my audio. Okay, so now you should see my whole desktop. Is that?
Yeah.
Okay. So then I have to go into my main, I don't even know what you call that thing. My main file thing, and I click on downloads because my video that I had on my phone, I airdropped it to my computer. So then I need to grab that from here. It'll be whatever the most recent thing you did. So then I just drag that in. This is my E flat video. Whoops. Okay. And of course I would have clapped three times and then you would see these little peaks. And oh, there's the sound. You see that little mountain here,
right?
Little yellow peak. So that's the audio from the video that you don't want, because you want this beautiful green audio that you did with your GarageBand. So on my computer, I just drag that down all the way to zero, and then you don't hear it.
Right. So it's the same functionality as the iPad version. It's just bigger and probably a bit more easy to navigate.
Mm-hmm. And then when you're ready to, because there's always going to be stuff at the beginning that you don't want. So that's where you kind of start to learn, okay, I need to add a marker here. And then this is like where I want it to start. I'm going to add a marker down there. And then you hold the R and you drag over to the left and then you hit delete. And then that goes away, all that extra stuff or movement that you don't want to have at the beginning of your video. And then you can.
And I'm wondering if you can do the same thing as on the iPad, where see the little black line to the left of your video, right there. Can you drag that over? I'm just curious to see if it works the same. Can you? Yeah, if you highlight that area, you should be able to. Almost. I saw a little. The arrow changes there. Yeah, and that might actually be the same functionality that. No, that looks like it's adjusting both audio and video tracks.
Yeah, I don't see. Do that because,
Gotcha. I wasn't sure if it was the same.
I usually drag it like this.
And fair. Yeah, that makes sense.
Peaks and valleys. So.
That works really nicely.
The peak and valley to like line up. So like, let's say those are my claps right here. So I'll line up the claps there, and then I delete all the stuff. You know, I'll pass the claps, of course, and then I line it up that way. So, I have no idea if that's the most you know, efficient way to use this. This was just from me messing with it and figuring things out. So I'm sure there are many more features that I have not discovered.
Story of our lives.
Right.
One Google search at a time.
That's right. But so that's, I think that's it. And then when I'm done, let's say this project is done. Oh, and if you want to know how I add my little titles, there's titles
here.
I just drag in all the way into the front. Sometimes I have to do it twice. I don't know why. Oh, that's really long. Oh, it's just because it's zoomed in, I think. So, and then you just click on the text here, and then you type in whatever you want it to be. And then when you push play, you'll see that. And then your video starts. And then you can do the same thing at the end. You can just add whatever you want. Like sometimes I say, like, have a great day or whatever. So, you know, just something a little extra if you want to do that stuff too.
Right.
And then to get it out of iMovie and to where I can post it, I go to File, Share, and all the way down to the bottom, File. And then I just leave all this stuff as is. And I hit Next. And then I can title it. And then when I hit Save, it'll go to my desktop. And then it's there. I can just drag it right in, or, you know, you select photo in Facebook or photo or video, and then you can just select the file by the title and then you can upload it.
Right. And, you know, it's a lot. Again, for Etude of the Week, it can be a lot of steps if you're in a hurry. Obviously, you can omit any number of these steps, I suppose, if you really wanted to make it really quick. But if you have the time, I think it really does pay off. And the skills apply really nicely to if you're making any other educational content for like YouTube or Facebook or wherever. I think the sort of skills that you're using here can apply to like a really wide range of online clarinet life. So
here is what it looks like when I'm ready to post. So here's where you type in what you're gonna post, blah, blah, blah. And then you hit photo video. And then I have everything saved in a little folder, Etude of the Week. And then you can just select your piece, hit open, and it'll start to prepare. It takes a while. It goes around this little circle. And when the circle is complete, then the blue post button will light itself up so you can actually click post. The first time I did this, I had no idea what was going on and why I was waiting. I was like, why won't it say post yet? And so then I did like it twice or something. So there was two videos the first time. But you just have to be a little patient. It takes about a minute to wrap all the way around and then it'll be ready to post. So I think that's it.
Yeah. If anyone has questions, just ask away in the comments and we should see them.
And do not be shy. We are the blind leading the blind, and we can help you Google, or you can Google things. I have found that if I talk to someone who's too much of an expert, it just goes over my head really quickly. So it's been really nice to have Trevor help me, because I was able to ask all of my stupid questions.
Right. I mean, they're not stupid. Yeah, absolutely. Anytime. And again, if you know exponentially more about this, just know that I'm trying to help the masses get started. So
the very basic, just to get started, to be able to record nice quality, just for Etude of the Week, you know, beyond that purpose, or like maybe for your lessons and things like that. So.
Right. Well, it's been fun.
Yeah, thank you so much, Trevor. We'll say bye.
See ya.